Yes. Oh, there it is. Hi. Welcome. Lovely to see you all. Welcome to my home. I live here and do concerts. Often, that's not sure I do a lot of you hear me going, oh, this isn't starting well. But lovely to see you. Welcome along to this splendid event. I don't know how many of you just attended the little VIP soiree down the road at the gallery. It was beautiful. If you didn't, it was really wonderful. Beautiful food, lovely wine. Thank God you arrived. I was getting stressed. I was just stalling. People were going, why isn't he being funny here? I'm waiting. So, my name is Greg Fleet. I'm going to be the MC of this event for various reasons. Primarily because they asked me to. And I don't know how to say no. I'm a people pleaser. And it's going to be wonderful. It's going to be great. We've got some incredible things happening. Some incredible panelists and I'll explain it all. First off, I'm going to talk you through the list of things that I have as we go. The Greg Fleet to open, I've done that. And it says housework, which I personally find insulting. I reckon I left the place fairly clean. I don't see why I have to do that. Point out emergency exit locations. Now that I would do if I knew where they were. No one told me. So I reckon if something bad happens, just panic. Seriously, just panic. Run around a lot yelling. That's good. I know there's one there. So all go for that. No, there's two more. Oh, they're coming out of the woodwork now. There's two upstairs if you want to be daring. Run up the stairs, out those, and then down the stairs to safety. There's probably someone back here. There's also a massive pipe organ if you want to add to the tension of anything bad happening. Just get on that. And I just went out the back and there's six pianos. I reckon that's too many. How many pianos do you really need? We often ask ourselves that question. There's an ant, a winged ant, crawling across my script. Brings me to my next point, which is that we're here to talk about mental health. Get off it. Just, I don't want to touch it. I mean, I don't mind touching it, but I want it to get off on its own accord. Not get off on its own accord, but I want it to get off there. That would be a bit wrong if that ant started pleasuring itself, but just crawl away. All right, do what you want. You are upsetting me though. So this is a kind of gruen transfer type scenario where due to economic reasons, they couldn't afford Will Anderson. So as I know him and I'm perfectly willing to impersonate him, they got me. I'm a cheaper, older, more lived-in version of Will, which I won't tell him, I said. By the way, he gives some lessons at this event. I did run this by him before I agreed to do it. I said, how do you feel about it? He was like, oh, awesome. Which is great. But the gruen effect is a moment a person stops shopping for an item in particular and begins to shopping in general. The phenomenon is frequently experienced inside shopping malls with all its dazzling displays and storefronts, noise and activity. As someone pointed out to me today, IKEA is a brilliant example of the gruen transfer. You probably know this stuff, I have no idea. But the psychological effect is named after the father of the shopping mall, Victor Gruen. As opposed to, a lot of people think it's named after Steve Transfer. But a little known man. The inventor of the transfer, ironically. Tonight we have invited two of Adelaide's leading creative agents, the world's leading creative agencies, to sell the unsellable. We also discuss why we buy and how we're sold, which apparently is a Will Anderson quote, so I did it in a different tempo than he would have done it. And I did it without shouting. Anyway. Now, during the event tonight, I encourage people to use social media throughout the event, other than when I'm speaking, obviously. But tweet, post, Instagram, and use the hashtag PHW, which stands for What? That sounded like mumbled nonsense to me. What? Somebody say, clear? What? Then you're just going, Bumble, isn't it? Public health week, indeed. And I wasn't asking that because I didn't know. Yes, I was. So, hashtag PWH Public Health Week 2017 and hashtag AdMental. Capital AD, capital M, you work it out. Can we create some trending from here and from all of those who have joined us for the Facebook Live feed? That didn't sound natural, did it, the way I said that? No, it's because I read it. Okay, so that's basically what we're doing. It's going to be really exciting. I've actually seen both the agencies have made ads, and they're incredible. I've seen both of them, and I don't know why. I just kind of went, oh, I bet you they'll be a bit shit. And I don't know why I thought that, but probably because I've seen a lot of ads, and they generally are. But these are both insanely good. Oh, God. That was a legitimate mistake. Now, I'll talk about this a bit later on, and we do tend to throw those terms around. I do a lot, without meaning to be vicious or hurtful. And it's akin to casual racism, I guess. Using terms like mental and insane and munter, and I use all those terms a lot, often to describe myself. But we'll talk about that a bit later on. Don't hate me. And so that's basically how we're going to go. It's going to be great, and I'm really excited about the night. But I would now like to invite to the stage Uncle Lewis O'Brien to do the welcome to country. Uncle Lewis, please.
Mani Bajunga, Gana Mian and Awamani, Mani Bundigani Gatana. Naibirito, Mangalangala, Tandanya, Mianaku. Naita Yungandalya, Naita Yakanandalya, Padnian Luwadu. On behalf of the Kaurna people, I welcome you all to Kaurna country, and I do as ambassador of the Adelaide Plains people. My brothers, my sisters, let's walk together in harmony. Natalia.
That was very concise. I could learn a lot from Uncle Lewis, and ironically, he's my actual uncle. Not long been with it. That was ill-advised. I thought I'd just have a crack at that. I'd like to thank you for being honest in the way you responded to that attempt at humour. You kind of went, yeah, but no. And that's good. That's all we need for this evening to be great. But thank you very much, Uncle Lewis. And, okay, it says here, hashtag Greg Fleet being Greg 10-minute comedy routine. That's a drag. I'm not really doing it from behind things, but I'll do it. Oh, hello. Have I won some awards already? No, they're for later. I will get onto them. They're going to be presented to the people whose ads go down the best. All right. It's lovely to be in Adelaide. I love Adelaide. I was just here for the Fringe. I've done every Fringe since 1988. I'm an unofficial ambassador to Adelaide. I've lived here before. I wrote a book here a couple of years ago. Ironically, I wrote a book here when I don't know if you know much about me, but I had a long history of drug addiction, which is kind of a mental health issue in quite a big way. So I did that for a long time and stopped doing that at some point. And I came here and wrote a book. I spent 3 months here, and it was the most beautiful, wonderful time with friends, and that book's gone very well, and I love Adelaide. I'm a massive fan of Don Dunstan. What a legend. Oh. I think I'm a little bit in love with Don Dunstan. I love Don Dunstan. I also love Mr. Purcell. Total legend. Actually, a friend of mine who lives here has a thing called Adelaide Jerks, and he's basically a rest of the world denier. He just only acknowledges things that come from Adelaide, and anything else he says comes from Adelaide. So he says ice cream was invented in Adelaide, and the moon launch was launched from Adelaide, whatever, right? And we're obsessed with Mr. Percival, Don Dunstan, Colin Teal, Backpack John, various Adelaide icons, and we love them, and we celebrate them a lot. I had a long-running drug addiction, which led to various behavioural situations that we in this country still treat as, and I don't care for me, because it's over for me, but going forward, I think eventually we'll evolve as a society and start treating drug addiction as a medical issue rather than a criminal one, and aside from the fact that it will help a lot of people reduce crime, save billions of dollars, etc., it'll just be better for everyone, and if we get onto it soon, we'll be able to be like 19th in the world rather than 80th, which is quite often the way we roll. One of the ways, I dealt with that my own way in the end. I went to rehabs and psychiatrists and fellowships and various things. In the end, I dealt with myself, and I invented my own method of health stopping taking drugs, which I call sitting on the couch, watching shitloads of Scandinavian episodic crime television, and eating everything. And it worked. It worked for me. It was a few years ago. Everything's been great since then. It's never reared its head again. I don't imagine it ever will. But I did develop a medical condition through that. The doctors call being a fat fucker. Do you know fat fucker? Yeah? I had that quite badly. If there's anyone here from overseas, fat for care? Je fat for care. I went from 75 kilos, which was my heroin fighting weight, to 138 kilos in an effort to get healthy. May have been slightly ill-advised, but my partner, bless her, she's a very smart woman, she thought that I should go to the gym, but she knew me well enough to know that if she said to me, hey, you should go to the gym, that I'd just be like, oh, fuck that. Oh, fuck the gym, fuck the man and his rules. I'm a rebel, baby, I ain't never gonna be no good. Pitcha-pitcha-pow-pow. And she also knew that I was quite childish. And one day she said to me, hey, maybe you should go to the gymio. And I was like, the what? And she went, the gymio. And I went, oh, yes, I should go to the gymio. That sounds amazing. And I just fired up. I got off the couch for the first time in a month. I'm like, I'm going to the gymio. It's going to be great. And she's like, okay. And I was going to get an Uber there. And I thought, no, I'm walking. I'm walking to the gymio. And she's like, are you sure? I'm like, yep. And I did. And I walked. I walked all the way there, it was like 40 metres. I was exhausted, but I don't know if you've ever been to a gym before, but let me tell you this for free. My God, do they want you to do a lot of shit. It is brutal. I mean, at first I just had to fill out a form, that was fine with that, fill out a form. You had to write your medical history. I was a bit like, oh, are you sure? Okay, here we go. And then there's like a little box where you write your life story. And I imagine most people just put, I was born here, I grew up here, I had this job, and I did this. But I'm a writer. So I'm like, oh, hello. Yes. Oh, we'll just turn this over and go on the other side, shall we? So, have you any more paper? Yes, bring it. And I said, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. The only ones for me are the mad ones, the ones who are mad to be born. Anyway, it became a novella. And, I go to the young guy behind the counter, the young guy at the gym, behind the counter, whose interests seem to run to fitness. And he read it all, and he was like, okay, bro, okay. So what do you want to do, eh? You want to do a bit of cardio, eh? I'm like, I didn't know what he was talking about. I didn't even know what you're saying, right? Because, you know, a bit of cardio, a bit of what, and some fucking brrrr, and a bit of that weird, wah, 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 wah. Then we'll do a bit of brrrr, and some, oh, dude, stop, please, stop talking. And he stopped, because he was young. And I said, bro, you've read my thing. Clearly, I don't give a solitary shit about my health. You just make me look better. It's all about the cosmetics, bros. And he looked at me like he knew what I was talking about. He went, oh, okay. Yeah, so you just want to get And I'm like, well, yeah, I want to get ripped, but is that cool before we work out? Kind of how I ended up in this situation. So we went down to the car park, smoked a couple of glasses, and let me tell you, did I lift some weight that day? No, that didn't happen, that didn't happen. I've been living in an area of Melbourne called South Yarra. I used to live in St Kilda for a very long time, and I moved for various reasons to South Yarra. South Yarra is a bit different. South Yarra is a bit zhuzhy. It's a bit, it's a bit tennis club. It's a bit Goodwood. It's a bit North Adelaide. It's charming. It's a bit Hello Boys. And it is white. Holy shit, is it white? It's like the whitest place I've ever seen. You go to the gym, in South Yarra, my gymio was right next to Channel 10. You go to a gym near a TV station, celebrities go there. I didn't know that. So I'm at the gym, I'm working at the gym, I see Dennis Rodman at my gym. Dennis Rodman, a former NBA player, American basketball player, star basketball player, played for the Chicago Bulls, played for the Detroit Pistons, incredible, played for the Dream Team, I played with Jordan and Pippen and and who is amazing, amazing basketballer, 7 foot tall, remarkable man, very bright, you know, and lots of piercings now, you know, looks so cool, like lots of piercings, and used to go with Madonna, loves doing annoying things, like he just goes to North Korea for no reason, just to annoy people, you know, pretty funny guy, but I'm like, oh my god, you see somebody 7 foot tall, you notice them, and then I'm like, oh my god, that's Dennis Rodman. Holy shit, Dennis Rodman is at my gym. This is amazing. South Yarra are letting black people in. You know, that's a real step in the right direction, South Yarra. You're learning. You know, admittedly millionaires, but that's, you know, it's a start. And I saw Chris Judd at my gym. Chris Judd, former AFL player, former captain of the Eagles, premiership player, Brownlow medalist, remarkable man, remarkable athlete. Recently retired, very handsome man, very erudite, seemingly, I don't know, educated, like very, very lucid. And he's at my gym in a suit. Just, you know, he's being led around by people who work at the gym. He's obviously checking out the gym to see if it's Judd worthy. But he's a, you know, very nice man and cool man. He wasn't being arrogant, he was just like checking it out, you know. But I see Chris Judd and I'm like, holy shit. I've seen Dennis Rodman. I wish I'd gone up and met Dennis Rodman. I'm like, I'm going to go meet Chris Judd. Yeah, that's what I'm doing. So I just started walking over to Chris Judd. And he's in his suit and he's incredible. I start walking over in my stupid t-shirt and my baggy shorts. And I get halfway towards Chris Judd and I start to lose confidence. And then not only do I lose mental confidence, I start losing physical dexterity. Judd, the more I think, oh, he's going to use it a charity event. This is horrific. And I get close to Chris Judd, and then I start resenting Chris Judd. I start resenting him for being so incredible, right? And I'm just like, ugh. And then by the time I get to him, I'm like a petulant child. I'm like, fucking Judd, you stupid bastard. And I see him, and I just begrudgingly put my hand out to shake his hand, and he goes, great fleet. And internally, I lost my tiny fucking mind, right? I was just like, holy shit! Chris Judd knows who I am! He knows me. But obviously, you know, externally, you're not going to do that. That'd be awkward. So externally, I just did a little dance. Possibly with a nautical theme. And we just shook hands, I let him get back to doing whatever he was doing, which I imagine involved fitness. But seeing Chris Judd at your gym, that's a tick of approval for your gym. That's pretty cool for the gym, having Chris Judd. Seeing Chris Judd at your gym, that's like seeing Ben Cousins at your dealer's house. Stamp of approval. Quiet as our tea product. Now I very much feel Ben Cousins. Not enough to not make that joke, but I do very much feel for him. As I said earlier, I think he's done some horrific things. He's on meth. People on meth do horrific things. And incredible footballer. I'd say a more skilled footballer than Chris Judd, one of the most amazing footballers. Also a Brownlow medalist, played with Judd, the Eagles, premiership player, incredible. But, you know, a man in a lot of pain and a lot of anguish and, you know, causing pain and anguish to other people, which is, you know, that's how it goes. But a lot of my friends don't agree. They don't think he should be treated as someone with a medical problem. And, you know, everyone's allowed to have their opinion. It's fine. It's a democracy, unlike America. But he, you know, a lot of my friends, especially in WA, they're like, nah, fuck him, mate. Fuck Chris Joe. I mean, fuck Ben Cousins, you know? He's an idiot, mate. Ben Cousins is an idiot, mate. He should go to prison. Not only, and he has recently gone to prison. You know, he should go to prison. Not only that, Ben Cousins, he should give his Brownlow back. He was on the meth. He was on meth, a performance-enhancing drug. He should give that Brownlow back. And I'm like, dude, I took shitloads of meth. I never won a Brownlow. I never got better at anything. The only remarkable thing I ever did was I took all the furniture out of our house one night and put it in the backyard in perfectly straight lines. And I mean perfectly straight. People don't know. I'll just tell you this before we move on very quickly. One of the great things about this job is travelling, coming to wonderful places and working to great people like you, working with the panelists and the wonderful people we've worked with tonight. Yeah, travelling around the country, travelling around the world, it's amazing. If that's what you're into, it's a great job. And if you're into working like 40 minutes a day, it is sweet. And you know, we travel around, do gigs all over the place. And one of the things we do sometimes, we do gigs for the troops. And I've done a couple of those tours for our soldiers in various war zones and locations around the world. And primarily I do gigs for the troops because I'm very pro-war. You know, I love war and I think there should be more of it. You know, whenever I do gigs for the troops, I like to get out there and do a bit of comedy, and then at the end I like to say, hey, good on you guys, you know, for being in this war, but, you know, never forget you can do more. You know, you can have more war. There's a few unsuspecting countries around here that are just ripe for invading. Have a crack. Because I think war's a good thing, and I think, you know, it's only ever benefited humanity, and I think we should really go for it. We've dropped off a bit recently, we used to be good at it, but we've really dropped the ball, and I think we need to commit to a bit more aggro internationally. And that's not true, I don't feel that way at all. I don't think anyone is really pro-war. I think, I almost said something. I almost said I really have to be to love war. So, but I am very proud of troops, and I love the troops. Troops are great. Soldiers are incredible people. Absolutely remarkable people. Absolutely, my friend. Brave, complex, skilled, remarkable people. And we do gigs for them. And they love the gigs. They love comedy. As you would. You know, when your day consists of, all right, we get up at 0800, we go out to Sniper Ridge. It's a capture or kill mission. Emphasis on kill. We get them, we come back on the way back, try not to step on any drive over any landmines or IEDs. We get back here, we debrief, we interrogate the prisoners. And then there's a comedy night. I enjoy that. It's great. I did a tour of East Timor, that was fascinating. And more recently, I did two gigs in Syria. Came back 6 weeks ago. Now, I didn't even know that we had troops in Syria. And to this day, I'm not sure that I'm meant to tell you that we do. But we do. So I did some gigs with wonderful Australian, Canadian, New Zealand and Syrian troops, men and women, incredible people, and also a lot of Syrian people, you know, just normal people. And I did two gigs. The gigs went really well. I had a really good time, fascinating country. And the day I left, I was allowed to go to a market and look around. So I'm doing that. I'm in a market. It's, you know, it's a classic market, you know, Arabic market environment. I'm checking that out. But I noticed at one stage there's this coffee shop, like a modern coffee shop, like a kind of almost like a Gloria Jeans or something, or Chibo there. And there's like five young people, kind of in Western dress. When I say young, I mean like mid-20s. Maybe one of the guys was maybe early 30s, had three men, two women. And they were looking at me, and they were talking about me. Now, I'm self-obsessed, but this was actually happening, right? And I'm walking around the market, and I'm going, no, they're definitely looking at me. And they were talking about it, but it didn't seem like they were saying anything good. But they were speaking Arabic, and I don't speak Arabic. So I'm just like, well, I think they're giving the fleet man the stink eye. you know? I'm like, what the hell? Then I had my phone on me, and comedians often record gigs, so I put my phone on to record, and then suddenly I'm like a really crap spy. And I'm trying to get near them, near enough to record what they're saying, but act busy. So I'm like, these two awards look good. I wouldn't mind buying a couple of those to take home for the family in this beautiful Arabic market. And, this I Heart Syria t-shirt looks pretty good. I might get one of those for my daughter. And I'm recording what they're saying. I get back to Melbourne, I go and see a friend of mine who works at Melbourne University. She's a linguist, she's a linguistics professor. I go and see her. She, in fact, used to be my girlfriend. And I go and see her, and I'm like, what's this? And I put it down on the table in her office, and we turn it on, and she's listening, and she goes, okay. And I go, what are they saying? She goes, they're five young people in a market. And I went, I know they're in a market, I was there! She went, whoa! And I'm sorry, I haven't really dealt with a breakup. Anyway, so she goes, what are they saying? She goes, listen to her, she goes, they're comedians. I know, and I was like, what? She went, they're five young comedians. And I went, oh my God. Like, they're Syrian comedians. It's two women, three guys, young Syrian comics. They were obviously at the gigs. They obviously saw me. They obviously hugged me. They were talking about me. But, I just thought they were dissing me. I didn't know. I don't speak, Arabic, so I didn't know. And I'm like, oh my God, that is so great. There's this, brotherhood and sisterhood of man across nations, this comic brethren and sisterhood. It's so cool. And I go, so what else are they saying? She goes, they're talking about you. And I'm like, yeah, what are they saying? She goes, they're saying, they come round here taking our jobs. That's a universal language right there. All right, enough of that. I've fulfilled my obligation there. thank you for finding that mildly entertaining. It's time to welcome on stage our first person who's going to chat with you, ladies and gentlemen. A wonderful person, a person who's going to give you knowledge about what we're attempting to do tonight. Please put your hands together and welcome to the stage the fabulous John Mannion from Flinders Foundation. Please.
Thanks very much for letting us join you today. My name is John Mannion. I'm the Head of Strategy and Projects at Flinders Foundation. I also have 29 years background in mental health, started obviously when I was about four, and started as a mental health nurse, became a social worker, went into community health services, came to Australia for a quiet life and became the director of the mental health services. And then joined our charity. And the charity I work for is one I'm very proud and passionate to work for. For those of you who don't know, Flinders Foundation, we aspire to be the leading foundation within medical discoveries and also advancing global healthcare. We recognise the burden of mental health and the impact it can have on the community. And Flinders Foundation decided to put our hand up to actually do something about this. And we wanted to actually be part of the solution. But we also realise that this is an enormous task and not something we can actually do on our own. So as a sign of our commitment and our want and wish to do something different, we're partnering today with the Don Dunstan Foundation as one of the major sponsors of tonight's event. The event really looks at doing something very, very differently. It's different, it's innovative, it's easy to write than it is to say. It's a different way in which we want to talk about mental health, to actually make the conversation of mental health a normal conversation to have, a safe conversation to have. And it's also one of the biggest health challenges we're actually facing. We've been working really, really closely with a whole range of different partners to try and look at what can we actually do, what can we invest that's going to have the best impact for our community. So we're working really, really closely with the Minister for Mental Health, Lisa Vlahos. And the fact that we have a state that has a minister for mental health, I think, is a really impressive step forward. We're working really closely with Chris Burns and the Mental Health Commission. One of the best outcomes we've had, I think, in the last few years is actually the establishment of the Mental Health Commission. They've got a small task to do. They've actually got to write a mental health plan for our whole state. Some would say that's a challenging task. Chris and his team are excited and want and wish to be part of that and want to drive that process. We want to drive it though, not just for now, and we want to be part of not just for now, don't want to be just part of now. We want to be part of the next 5 years, the next 10 years, and then the next 20 years, so that we're actually developing services for the future. Some of the research that we've been involved in, because people won't really know who the Flinders Foundation are, because we're based in the south, and we're trying to say where we want to actually be part of the bigger picture. One of the things we've really looked at is actually the connection between translation of real outcomes for our community, real outcomes for patients and for their families. Trying to bring together skilled clinicians, skilled researchers, and the wider community to have the biggest impact. We know that this has been a real challenge, but we don't believe that shouldn't be a way in which we can actually move forward with mental health. We've had a strong history of success, predominantly in the cancer field, where we've actually looked at bringing research and cancer care together. But we see that mental health is the next new cancer. We see that we really can look at different ways in which we can actually look at the prevalence and reduce the prevalence, but also ways in which we look at the research, early intervention, and prevention to actually make a real difference. Thinking outside the box, though, is something we've really got to do. If we continue to do the same thing, we'll get the same outcome. Tonight is an excellent opportunity to think outside of that box. It's a great way in which we can have meaningful conversations. We can actually mention the word MAD and it not be looked at as a derogatory term. But also it looks at a way in which we can try and raise awareness, can assist us to feel comfortable about having difficult conversations, to challenge stigma and discrimination that's ultimately a real challenge for everyone who has a mental health challenge. We also want to look at how we can deliver better outcomes for our families, our friends and our community for the future. So if you'd like to know more about what the Foundation, Flinders Foundation, are looking at doing, let's be careful with the Foundation because we're too many here today. But if you want to look at what we're doing, please come and see me afterwards. Most of our team are here today. We're wanting to look at some new and inventive ways in which we make a difference. But also really would like to thank David and his team for facilitating tonight's event. This is really exciting and I've got a really good seat at the front, which is great. And I'm really good that I've got through my speech because I forgot my glasses. But also I'm really looking forward to the two pitches. You know, to have that conversation and be really bold to say, how do you tackle mental health? I'm really looking forward to the answer to that. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. And now I would like to welcome to the stage the Director of Wellbeing and Resilience Centre, SA Health and Medical Research Institute, to talk about South Australia as a state of wellbeing. Please welcome the fabulous Gabrielle Keller. That's it.
Well, Greg, I'm glad you were talking about throwing some terms around because that's what I'd like to do fairly quickly. I've just got two main things to say. First is to throw some terms around to you, at you, with you, for you. And the second one is to introduce the Wellbeing and Resilience Centre because tonight's objective is really straight down the barrel of our mission, which is to build mental wellbeing and resilience at scale across South Australia as a prototype for the world. So let's talk about terms for a minute. Mental health is a word that's used to carry many meanings. Actually, mental health, in many circumstances, is said to mean mental illness. And I have to look around because I don't have a thing in front of me, so I have to check where my slides are. But what it actually refers to is high levels of mental well-being and resilience, lower levels or decreasing levels or well-managed levels of mental illness, and it also refers to the environmental or social determinant factors that play an important role in mental health and mental illness. So it tends to have to do some really heavy lifting in the concepts that it holds together. Now, if you look at this diagram here and you think of yourself, if you think about these quadrants, they really refer to the sort of 0 to 10. I can be 0 to 10 mentally healthy, mental well-being. I can be 0 to 10 mentally ill. And there can be 0 to 10 degrees of severity with which social determinants or my life circumstances or the events that I'm born into in my life affect my well-being and my ability to be mentally healthy in my life. What we want, really, is a state of complete mental health. If we go to the next slide, you can see that if everybody gets measured for mental well-being or mental illness, a whole society, a whole community, a whole country can end up being plotted on that graph of mental complete mental health and complete mental illness. And if we go to the next graph, you can see where we have to work. And sorry, I really do. Sorry, I have to look around. So can I have the next one, the next two, please? This really is where we're talking about tonight, what we have to do. We have to build well-being, we have to address mental illness, and we have to account for or mitigate environmental factors or determinants for health. And we've got to do all of those things all at the same time. And in a society like ours, there are different people, I'm sure there are many of you here tonight, who are responsible for various of those jobs. We, with many other people in South Australia, are about building mental well-being. But there are many of you and many others who are totally dedicated to overcoming mental illness or assisting people with mental illness. And then there are others who are really about trying to get social justice, improve homelessness, improve unemployment, etc., and all of those things that can happen to people that have an impact on their mental health. So back to us, we are the Centre for Wellbeing and Resilience in the Mind and Brain theme at SAMRI. Our objective is to build South Australia as a state of wellbeing, as a prototype for the world. So to learn about building wellbeing at scale here as efficiently and effectively as we can, so that other people can do it after we publish our research about how we've done it. Our approach generally is we take a vector approach. We are addressing the mental well-being needs and aspirations and hope of the whole society. So we're looking everywhere. And we look everywhere to groups of people who have trusted relationships with other groups of people. For example, the public sector has 100,000 people in South Australia. There might be one or four people around those people in the public sector. That could be 300,000 people that you could reach just by doing measuring and building well-being in the public sector. If you measure and build the well-being in all the schools of the state, think of the impact that it would have across the children and the families and the communities. And you can see in that little list there, if you give me the next one, look at the numbers. We're looking at well-being at scale, and to do that we have to work with partners and collaborators, people who own those relationships, whether you're insurance companies, whether you're banks, whether you're the fire brigade, whether you're the corrections service, and we're working with SA Corrections very closely in order to be able to reach people with the scientifically validated knowledge and skills about how to build well-being. And what we do in our business is we measure well-being using PERMA Plus, positive emotion, engagement, relationships, meaning and accomplishment. If you build those things, that's a dashboard of well-being, and your well-being will be improved. If you build it for yourself, you'll build your own well-being. If you build it for your family or for your business or for your school, their well-being will be improved. And that's been proven to be so. But we also take an interest in physical activity, nutrition, sleep and optimism, because we find that the community is really interested in resilience for the modern world, and we know that the links between physical health and well-being, mental well-being, are very strong. The evidence tells us so. We call it PERMA Plus. We want to see that on buses. We want this society to absorb that understanding, just like we absorb the understanding of slip, slop, slap, to remind us what we have to do to keep ourselves free from cancer. So PERMA Plus is an important part of our strategy. The other important part of our strategy is that we use a lead, measure, build and embed approach. We're not just about piping the information from the scientists into courses to give people one course. We are about how do you build the sustainable, consistent well-being of organisations, large and small, families and communities, for the long term in this state, for a long-term movement of population mental health and mental well-being. That's what we're after. So we are building the state of well-being. Various countries and colleagues around the world are taking a lot of interest in what we're doing in South Australia. Mexico, China, England, Dubai, all see us as being world leaders in this aspiration to build population mental well-being. And they're visiting South Australia, and we see this as the beginning of the attention that South Australia can get to our research, on the back of which we can together, and I say together advisedly, only with deep collaboration and partnership, we can build an industry for wellbeing and resilience products, services and solutions, if we work together to build the state of wellbeing. That's all I've got to say. On with the evening. Thank you very much.
Before we get on, I was going to do this earlier and I'm going to do it now because I have the microphone. My friend Lawrence Mooney, who's a comedian, a great comedian and probably my closest friend, was telling me he grew up in the outer suburbs of Melbourne in quite a tough environment. His father died when he was quite young, he had a lot of brothers, a very tough, you know, not cruel or unnatural, but, you know, very, very tough neighbourhood and a lot of boys and a lot girls, and he grew up in that environment, and you know, beautiful people that loved each other very much and had a sense of community, but not a lot of talking, a lot of stoicism, a lot of people holding things in. And he was telling me the other day that a guy who he'd actually told me about before, who was a friend of his older brother to me, his growing up, had recently committed suicide. And we were talking about that and talking about suicide in general, and the fact that we knew a lot of people who'd done it, a lot of, particularly a lot of men, and that it's often very brutal with men and very graphic, and what that says, and we got quite emotional. I mean, we're both idiots, and we're both, you know, comedians, and we love saying hideous things to each other and joking about anything, but we got into this particular conversation, and we got quite, he was telling me about all the details of his friend's death, and it was very, very gruesome, and his in his mid-50s, this guy, he lived with his family, his parents, his entire life. His parents were probably in their 70s, 80s, 80s, I guess. He had never had a partner because he didn't feel he was worthy of having a partner, so he lived with his parents his entire life. He was a labourer, a very good, skilled labourer. He apparently, at the time of his death, had over $1 million in the bank because he didn't spend his money, he didn't drink. But we were talking about this, and it reminded me of where I grew up in a different way. I grew up on the coast of Victoria, and a lot of that marginalised, slightly odd, suburban, rural, weird thing, you know, that so many of us know, and you know, it's no different than the city, I guess. But we talked about it, and on the plane on the way here, I was thinking about that, because, you know, he and I maybe once or twice a year had quite a meaningful conversation. The rest of the time it's very, very light and ridiculous. And I wrote this on the plane, and I'm going to read it. It's a little bit dark, but I hope it kind of sums up. I put it up on Facebook, and a lot of people have enjoyed it, so I hope you do. It's called Funeral on Maranova Street. The other thing was, he said that at the wake of the stoicism of this guy's father, who talked about finding his body, but very practical. No one's emotional, very practical, very, you know, this is what happened, and I did this, and guys at the wake were doing speeches, and they kept talking about the address, this house where these people lived. It was a significant house to all of them on this particular street. I've made up a different street, but that, you know, they kept talking about that street, you know, and we always go back to such and such street, and you know, this special thing. And so I wrote this anyway. So here we go. It's called Funeral on Maranova Street, with big love from my dearest friend Lawrence Mooney. Danny bought the hock shop and Nina's up the duff. Jenny lost her eldest boy over Mount Surrender Bluff. Jimmy's feeling confident his greyhounds are on the heat, and the Chinese restaurant just closed down on Maranova Street. Thumper's on the tools again. He works for Gary's dad. He still talks about that lotto win and all the cash he had. And Cindy's back in hospital. The tumours all came back. Ronnie's being stoic, but we all know that it will crack. And Tammy smiles through gritted teeth as she buys the family's meat, because no one fucking gets divorced on Maranova Street. The footy team are talking tough and the netball girls are pissed, and no one mentions Billy or how badly he has missed. But Jabba gets parole soon and his mum will be relieved. You could fill a fucking mansion with all the things he's thieved. And the kids are just high-spirited and they make our lives complete, because there's no such thing as ADD on Maranova Street. Stiffy Bristow's doing monos on Ronaldo Lawson's bike. He's still in love with Cheryl, but she's told him she's a dyke. And Denny's band are getting good. They're like a localised Chet Faker. And Jules said she saw Billy's ghost out by the Widowmaker. Told Jerry Copter King he was such a fucking shame. He was going to be a doctor, but he's never been the same. Well, my brother owns the bakery if he wants something to eat. The best sausage rolls in Victoria on Maranova Street. And Gary said he'd had enough, I'm going to leave this place. But he rolled his sister's Commodore when he was off his face. And Gary's dad at the hospital said he didn't want a scene. The only time I saw him cry was when they turned off the machine. So it's Gary's funeral today in this crushing, brutal heat. It seems there's truly no escape from Maranova Street. The footy boys all turned up pissed. They wear frustration like a shirt. And they hang shit on the minister and they wonder if it hurt. In the car park they get rowdy, drinking Bundy from the can, and no one wants to ask himself what it means to be a man. But at the wake, the boys are gentle. They get Gary's dad a seat, and someone's cooking sausage rolls on Maranova Street. And there's a picture of a street. I added the picture because I thought it would be more visual. You can't see that. All right. So that was weird. Okay, let's get on with something more entertaining. Thank you again to Gary, it was sensational. And you talked very quickly, you got a lot of information out lucidly. All right, I'd like to invite our panel members up to the stage. You may be wondering if this is just an installation, but no, it shall be used by actual humans. Ladies and gentlemen, please, I'm going to mispronounce some people's names. Please welcome each of our members to the stage. First off, Dr. Benjamin Grindley, Director of Marketing and Communications at the University of Adelaide. Dr. Benjamin, please come up and join us. What a young doctor you are. What a young and handsome suited doctor. Natasha Miliotis, Chief Executive Officer of Mental Illness Fellowship South Australia. Hi. Avail yourself of the water. Professor, now it's, I was going to say Julio, but it's Julio. Okay, and you look like a serious man, you're going to say it right. Please welcome Professor Julio Licinio. Close enough? Good. Deputy Director for Transition and Translational Medicine and Head Mind and Brain Thing at SAHMRI. Welcome, Julio. Professor Julio. A name I'm very comfortable saying, Geoff Robertson. What a great Geoff Robertson. What a great man. What an easily said name. He did that for me. Geoff, please join the CEO and Creative Director of Jam Shop, strategically led independent creative communications business. And finally, Dr. Jill Hibbs, founder of MAD for Peace, MAD for Peace Consultancy, MAD Minds. Welcome. I'm sorry. So far away. Please welcome and grab a seat. So that's our panel. Okay. I don't know if I'm. I think it's where I danced. No. Okay. Greg introduces the pitch. We all know and recognise that people suffer from mental illness. Sadly, there is still a stigma attached to it, but we are slowly working to get beyond that stigma. We don't really discuss or talk. What we don't discuss or talk about is mental and emotional well-being. What do we really know about the things that help us maintain that situation, mental well-being? I think we possibly do talk about mental illness, probably not as much as we should, but we very rarely talk about the flip side of that, which is mental well-being. How do we get people to stop and smell the roses? That's not a line I would have used, but I think you get the drift. How do we get policymakers and planners creating the environments and infrastructure that allow us to step back and think about our mental and emotional well-being? We have iconic public health campaigns from the 90s that kind of approach this. Some of you may remember Norm, the face of the Life Begin campaign. I think we have a bit of Norm coming up on the screens, I believe. I'll keep talking until it happens. He's like me before the junior. Love the leggings. Don't write to that address. It was, you have to send that letter to the past. A film script. We have public health campaigns that have actually triggered intuitive behaviours and policy changes. We don't want to get skin cancer, as Gabe mentioned, so we put on sunscreen, thanks largely, to campaigns like the very successful Snip, Slop, Slap campaigns of the 80s. Let's check it out now. It was very dark then, obviously. But, right, 1980.
Something you might certainly know, especially if you care about small
Ford Coppola directed that ad. leave that alone. So what is our mental slip, slop, slap? What is our mental t-shirt, sunscreen, hat type arrangement? That is what our two fantastic creative agencies, who have very generously donated their time to compete in this event, are aiming to achieve tonight. And it's time to welcome two representatives of those agencies to you. I believe some thematic music is about to build furiously. Or not. I can sing it, I know it. It's Eye of the Tiger. It says here, but maybe not. Or maybe that's what that, no, it says play Eye of the Tiger. Is that an instruction to me? Do I literally have to play Eye of the Tiger? Is that it? No, that's... from that should say every one of them similar. What? What the? I want to get fit. Exception. Please welcome Josh Welbourn from Welbourn O'Brien and John Gardner from Black Sheep Advertising. Please welcome both of them to the stage. Come up. Come up and sit. Welcome. Great to see you. Great to see you again. We saw each other at the VIP event earlier. Were you there? Oh, never mind. Okay. Oh, this says read over music, so I totally screwed that bit up. Welbourn O'Brien, founded in 2015 by Josh Welbourn and Troy O'Brien. Welbourn O'Brien exists to create loyal brand fans through meaningful dialogue, engagement, entertainment, and technology. Fueled by experience and a desire to innovate through collaboration, Welbourn O'Brien's credentials extend across strategy, creative media, production, and digital to provide everything you want and nothing you don't. Very nice. Let's hear it from them. I'm just saying, as an advertising person, what did you think of that as a voiceover? Like, do you reckon you can give me some word of that? I mean, that was the first one. That's John Roger. Oh yeah, okay. And also please, Black Sheep. Black Sheep describe their creative process as explore, discover, create. They don't presume to know the answers. Sometimes they don't even know the questions. But they work towards serving their clients' business objectives. They work across all media platforms and offer services including community engagement and environmental design. Let's hear it for both of these wonderful agencies. Josh and John. Music fade once J and J are on stage. Okay, I may have just kind of blown that a bit. It says we tossed a coin to see which agency would go first. That's not what we did. We threw a dart at a duck. A cruel and unnatural age-old advertising decision-making process. And Welbourn O'Brien won the toss. Josh, how did you approach this issue, and how did you? I'm going to say this to both of you. When they asked me to do this, and I mean this sincerely, they said, "Are we going to get two agencies to do ads, you know, for mental health?" Because of having seen Gruen sometimes, I thought that you guys were going to do ads for mental illness. Like, I thought you were going to go, like, how great's mental illness, you know? Let's get a bit of that in you. And I was thinking, that's a difficult sell. But fortunately, that's not what happened. It would be a bit of a downer, wouldn't it? So how did Welbourn O'Brien tackle the mental wellbeing sell, and how did they go? I guess you come up here, or? Yeah, you come up here. No, please, round of applause.
What a fantastic evening, and to see it so heavily attended. As an agency, we're honoured to be a part of this, what we see as an issue that does need some attention and probably hasn't had the appropriate attention that it deserves. So, for too long, mental health has been considered someone else's problem, or something that we don't want to touch, or something we don't want to deal with. For too long, it's been in the shadows. It's not true that it's someone else's problem. When the agency got together and started talking about, I guess, the conceptual thought behind our ad and the best way to approach this problem, there was a statistic that we found out, which was frightening little way. Statistically, one in five people are suffering from mental illness. So at the dinner table, business meetings, social events, when you drop the kids off at school, probably many situations throughout your day, someone needs assistance. And that might just be acknowledging that, you know, they need assistance, and giving them some help in some way. So therefore, that statistic became our compelling motivator. We're asking South Australia to share the responsibility. We're talking about creating a state of well-being which will result in healthy people, healthy families, healthy businesses, healthy communities. That's all of our responsibility. We work together towards creating a state of well-being, and all of us enjoy a better life in all aspects of our life. So the first step, though, was to identify the problem and to shine a light on that problem. So we've been asked to create an awareness campaign, I guess. So this campaign isn't giving, I guess, people the tools to engage and assist at this stage. This was more about making people aware that there is a problem, and it's something that shouldn't have a stigma attached to it, and something that we can all do our part to assist. So, but given the sensitive topic as well, we wanted to make sure that we created a visual metaphor that didn't alienate or isolate people that maybe do need a little bit of assistance. So we're asking everyone in this room to help share the responsibility to create a state of well-being by shining a light on the problem. So enjoy. Friends, or one in five family members, one in five co-workers, or one in five employees. Time to shine a light on mental health and start the conversation, because to achieve a state of well-being, mental health is everyone's responsibility. To play your part, visit dunstan.org.au.
Look, the campaign objectives were fairly clear, and that's the place we started with, I suppose. They are very quickly to increase awareness of the conditions that sustain and undermine mental well-being, to inspire individuals and community members and policymakers, and finally, to promote practices that support emotional and mental well-being. There's a fairly well-known truism in advertising, and that is that attitudes actually follow behaviour. So, in our thinking, we kind of put the third objective to the top. And the third objective was all about practice. It was about behaviour. it's been proven with things like seatbelts. So they were put in cars, but they weren't used for years until it became law. And now, I guess, when you get into a car, it's second nature. So the action of putting on a seatbelt actually drives attitudes towards road safety. So cracking that third objective was really going to help us solve the first two. So look, just a little exercise. I'd like everyone to take three deep breaths with me. So one, two, don't hyperventilate, three. So what you're feeling is actually a lowering of your blood pressure. It's physiological, it's real. It's also giving your brain a kick of oxygen, which is, for some of us, pretty handy. It's expelling CO2 out of your bloodstream. And it kind of just feels good. It's this instant kind of warm, good feeling. And that's kind of where we started. So we think that a few deep breaths is where we should start. It's a simple action. It can change the way we feel. It's a behaviour, and hopefully it will change attitudes. Thank you. Yet we all experience issues of mental health. Fear, sadness, anxiety and stress can upset the balance of our lives and affect our health and well-being. But there is something you can do. It's simple, scientifically proven, and takes less than 15 seconds. Each day, take time, pause, and breathe deeply through your nose. Hold, and breathe out through your mouth. Three times is enough to feel better. So take a moment, take a breath. Your body and mind will love you for it. If you or someone you know is having ongoing bad days, talk to your doctor.
So you just go, man. I'll start with Dr. Benjamin Grimley, Director of Marketing Communications, University of Adelaide. How do you feel about the ads?
Congratulations to both excellent ads. I think the characteristics of a lot of successful ads are that they're memorable, so they're easily recalled, they're relatable, and there's a call to action. And I think both of those ads manage that to varying degrees. Both normalise. I think that's done really well. It could be our family, our friends, our colleagues. Very relatable in that way. The marbles advert is really clever. I think there's a strong device that often is a negative connotation. I think that's been sort of flipped around, which was good. The breathe advert, I think, is good because it provides an action. And often, a good ad is about providing the viewer with an action that they can take. So it talks to a solution. Arguably, it might trivialise it a little bit, but at the end, I think that there is sort of that comment around if you or those that you.
Well, yeah, no, it's probably also a case of normalising, for want of a better term, but trivialising is a different term, but to bring it to a place where people go, oh yeah, and it's. I can do that. I can, absolutely. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
I'm happy to hand over. I think both really excellent.
Fantastic. Natasha, Chief Executive Officer of Mental Illness Fellowship SA. What did you think of what you just saw?
A great refers to a group of illnesses such as depression, schizophrenia and anxiety, in much the same way that heart disease refers to a group of conditions that affect the heart. And it's challenging to depict mental illness in a way that doesn't set up myths and stereotypes. And also, we don't have visual cues like we do a lot of physical illnesses, mm-hmm. such as a wheelchair or a seeing eye dog. And so I particularly liked the Losing My Marbles, as I'll call it, advert, because it uses a statement that we use in our everyday language. It is one that hooked me in. It's something that we will remember. But I particularly like the call to action in that once the marbles are dropped, it's the family members or the community around. We see those characters come and pick them up. And I'd love to see a part two of that ad where we see what people do to come around the person and to give the marbles back or to create that environment where they regain their mental health.
Yeah.
In a similar way, absolutely build on Ben's point that Slip, Slop, Slap, I saw a number of the audience swaying to that tune. We remember it, it's catchy from many of our childhoods. And I like the concept that while we know, and I tell my kids to slip, slop, slap, to breathe is something that we can all do. However, working in the mental illness area, what we hear a lot is people who say we don't understand mental health or mental illness will say, just get over it. You know, what? You've got a great life, why are you depressed? You know, what have you got to be sad about? So I think we've got to be careful about the audience. I think it's a wonderful message for the community. But I think the target audience needs to be carefully chosen, because for people who are experiencing mental illness, it's so much more than breathing. But I can see that there's a public health message there, which is very clever.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Jim Robertson, CEO and Creative Director of Jam Shop, strategically led independent creative communications business. Do you reckon when you saw those, did you think I could have done this so much better?
Yeah, we had those ideas last year. No, the first one, Losing Your Marbles, I think it's fantastic. It's intriguing. It's an intriguing visual. It's sort of the unseen pain that's actually now visible, you know, in a way, which is an interesting way of going about it. It's well constructed. The ad is really well put together. It resolves with this supportive community, the very thing that you were saying, Natasha. But I can't help but feel that Losing Your Marbles is, you know, it's a bit shallow for me. And I guess it depends where you come from in terms of your experience. I understand that you want to make a heavy topic a bit more accessible, you know, but for me, it just felt like this was about persuading others to create the right sort of environment, which I think you've done it in a way, but it just felt a little bit live for me.
So you hate Josh, you're saying you hate.
This is my return. Who knows what I mean? Then Take a Breath, on the other hand, I thought that Take a Breath was, this is a really simple idea. The action it presents actually signals the problem as well as the solution. It's as if Take a Breath is a moment in time that you not only make your other people are aware of you, but you make yourself aware of the situation you're in. It also acts as a trigger to watch out for others. And I actually think that it's very powerful. It creates a positive environment. It gives everyone room to breathe, if you like. Anyone from any business or community can relate to this. And they actually have the power to change things. I found it really insightful and sensitive. And see your doctor, I'm not sure is the best way to end something like that, but that's just me. But I love the simplicity of the approach and the way that it can actually change behaviour, because I think that whole behaviour thing is a very interesting thing. That, you know, you need to take action to do those sorts of things. Normalise that action, and then you can change behaviour. So I thought the work both excellent.
Thank you. Yeah, and that's, I think that's a really interesting point too, because it sort of suggested to me, if you're experiencing, you know, symptoms or stress, to take a breath, but also the people around someone experiencing that can do the same thing, you know, take a breath and then try to help or deal with it. I'd like to see both ads put together. Someone taking a breath and then helping to find it.
We in the advertising industry, we'd call you the perfect client.
But I've got no money. Julio, the deputy director for translational medicine and head of mind brain theme at SAHMRI. Before I get you to talk about the ads, what exactly is translational medicine?
Hello. It's bringing research from the realm of pure research into clinical practice. So translating the outcomes of what's, you know, done in the lab or in evidence gathering into actual clinical practice. And one thing which is very interesting, I just saw this recently, that when like a very definitive study is done, like say to treat, you know, a new treatment of hypertension, that's what really should be done. And when that's published in a top journal, to when GPs are actually doing that in practice, it takes 17 years.
Wow. How are you working at reducing that gap?
Yeah, that's my job.
Next year we're going to meet here, and if it's not down to 16 years, you're out. Okay. So what did you think of the two ads?
Do you know, I'm originally from Brazil, and there is a proverb in Portuguese that says, "In cada cabeça, mundo." Like in each person's head, like a different world. So I heard the comments from you know, my colleagues here about the ads, and you know, I agree with the words, but I feel a little differently than what some of the comments were. So I mean, there was a lot of thought and you know, good intention and hard work put in each ad. I have some, having worked in mental health for a long time, I have some, you know, issues that I like, your hot buttons that people touch. So one that Natasha said is this idea that, you know, if you only do this, if you only do the next thing, then you'll be better, which may work for some people, but for others it doesn't. So the breathing ad, I like the idea overall, but I think it perpetuates that notion of putting the burden of doing something on the person. And of course, if you do that, if you're just sitting at home and just, you know, feeling depressed and don't, you know, lift a finger, nothing's gonna change. But it's not necessarily because you did something that then things will, you know, mandatorily change. So they may or may not change. And I think we don't pay enough attention to the people that are not helped by what we do. So, and in the other end, there was one thing that I really liked, which was the 1 in 5. Because we really tend to stigmatize mental illness to this day and to see those with it as the other. So there are other people who are out there who are not me, certainly, and who are not, you know, around me, and I'm not in the place that I work, and I'm not in my house, and they are like, they are there, and I'm here. And that ad made it very clear to everybody that's like, it's 1 in 5, you know, in your workplace, in your house, in your neighborhood, whatever, you know, the areas were cited. So I thought that was very powerful. I did not necessarily like the ending of that, but I think if you have one take-home message that is very, you know, strong and people remember later, that's good enough for me. So I think that the idea that, you know, you watch that and you say, okay, it's like, you know, we have how many, 1, 2, 3, right? So one of us. So it's one of us, it's 2 people in the first row here, and 2 people in the next row. And you know, so many people in the place where you work and so many people in your household. And I think this idea that those with mental illness are not the other, but are like one of us, is really so crucial that I like that component a lot. So I was very impressed, taken by that.
Thank you very much. And now, Jill Hicks, Dr. Jill, I'm sorry. No, thank you. So, I don't need that. Was that not for me? Okay. Dr. Jill Hicks, before you talk about the ads, can you tell us, you're the founder of MAD for Peace, Man for Peace, can you tell us what that means?
Mad for Peace is a network, an organisation that looks at the collective good that can be done after, say, a destructive event. So we love working to a practice at the moment for every, say, terrorist attack that happens in the world, go off and do five great things.
You were involved in a terrorist attack?
Yes, lost both of my legs in 2005 in London in the underground bombing, and have since then have worked in countering violent extremism. A lot of my colleagues are former extremists. So mental health issues, I'm privy to a variety of all different types of mental health issues, including my own post-traumatic stress disorder, which very interestingly was kicked in 7 years after the event. So from my own personal experience, what was very interesting is immediately you're loaded up with all the help you could possibly need. And I remember having almost three different psych teams come and see me in hospital, and I was trying to think, okay, what would a grown-up person do in this situation? Would you like a chocolate? You know, and it was very interesting to think that that's not when I really needed it, because I was just euphoric that I was even alive, and not even was I just alive, but I was still me.
Yeah.
And so those things were just extraordinary, but 7 years afterwards, wham. And so for me, looking at the ads, I'm trying to put into context both the work I do, but also my own personal take. And one of the greatest techniques for anxiety is to breathe. So I was quite taken with the art of breathing, because of course it's something we all do, as Natasha said, but it's necessary to survive. If we don't breathe, we're dead. So I thought there was something really powerful about remembering to be conscious of our breath and the art of breathing to survive. Then I also thought that actually there's a couple of different topics here that we could start to really delve into, which is, should we talk about mental health or should we talk about mind health? And what are the vast differences? Because I'm sure that it's much easier to sit with a group of people and say, actually, I'm having some interesting thoughts and I'd like to be more conscious and aware of my mind and where my thoughts are taking me. But I might not sit down and say, I'm having mental health issues. So in that context, I saw the two campaigns as addressing very different things. The first, with the breath, I felt was very much talking to a mind health, that all of us can be conscious and more conscious of our thoughts, because our thoughts ultimately become our actions. And the second, I felt, was absolutely talking to mental health, with the beautiful reference there of, he's lost his marbles. Well, don't worry, we'll help you find the marbles. So I thought they were very different campaigns, but to me, talking to two different states of being, of mind health and mental health.
Had eye contact, and I felt as though you were talking about my work. We loved the way that this happened. I was starting to go, the agency, we thought about that, and I suddenly thought, hang on, what am I doing? But, excellent. Now, we roll along. All right, so we've heard, ideally, we would have, a lot longer if I had not decided to read an epic poem. We'll have longer to talk to his incredibly educated and wonderful panelists, but they will think about both the pictures that they saw, both the ads, and will come up with a choice as to which is their favourite, which will win one of these wonderful awards. And then there will also be a People's Choice Award where you get to, as an audience, vote on what you think is the better one. What's the time, by the way? 8 o'clock? Okay, it says here, 7 p.m. Greg introduces the pitch. No, we've done, of course we've done that. Oh, wonderful, I was totally going, you can't be an hour behind. I'm used to being 40 minutes behind, so not an hour. All right, I would like to invite Anna Bairdsley-Jones, co-president of Adelaide Advertising and Design Club and content director of Jam Shop, to present the trophy on behalf of the AADC and say a few words. So Hannah's going to speak, and then I'm going to find out who that is. Thank you, Anna.
What is advertising? Is it a disruption to your TV show or delay in starting your YouTube video? Is it an expensive addition to your yearly budget? Is it a public service or a form of psychic pollution? I think that it can be all of these things. So why am I a president of the South Australian body that represents the industry that makes it all? Because I believe advertising is a tool that can be used to make a difference in people's lives. And I'm not alone. I work with talented, creative people who produce ideas. Ideas that help grow business, that sustains our livelihoods and changes society. Proof of their passion and ability to do so is what's brought our industries together tonight. And it is also proof that we are committed to making a positive change in this world. Mental health is an illness close to home for many in our community. My co-president, Geoff Robertson, died just a few weeks ago. He was passionate about the cause. Many others within our creative community, who I know personally, have had their lives affected by it. We all know raising awareness and considering well-being from a mental health perspective is important. Understanding it will have a significant effect on the quality of life for all South Australians. Many of you here this evening make an honourable commitment to the cause every day. It is with respect for what you do and what you believe in that we as an industry are happy to help. I know this help has been extended beyond this evening. Many in this business have assisted over and above, working with marketing teams in your fields. Like yours, the advertising and design industry too struggles. The thing that we give is ideas. We give something that connects, something that engages, something with a strategy behind it. It's not just commentary. It's like the fuel for changing thinking. How do you put a price on that? Put aside the madman stereotype, it's hard work. Often underpaid and thankless. I would urge you all tonight not to see Black Sheep and Welbourn O'Brien fighting it out for a status update. They have donated their time and talents to a cause that we respect and want to see grow. We hope it proves to you that advertising exists not just to clog your Facebook feeds, but because when used effectively, it helps those help others. And it is a vehicle to communicate to everyone else, including those with lesser knowledge. Thank you for seeing us as partners in this, by inviting us to contribute and celebrate a worthy cause. Thank you to the AADC members for coming to show your support of mental health and also your colleagues. Thank you to our participants, to Nation for your help in organising, and thank you to our judges. Our industry is driven by ideas, and that can change the world. Keep that in mind in tonight's discussions. Now, let's present some awards, which we have named in memory of Geoff Robertson. I wish Geoff were here alongside me tonight. He really was the one that spearheaded AADC's involvement in this event. Geoff was an extraordinary creative talent. He turned everything he touched into beautifully crafted, magnificently art-directed fun. He was a leader, one who stood beside us and made us all better people. He was a man clients loved and creative people wanted to work with. In fact, I don't think I ever heard Geoff call work, work. In partnership with Greg, his best friend and business partner, Nation was formed. I think their business is such a success because it's not built just on smarts, but with passion and integrity. They've created a place where clients are like partners and staff can grow and realise their dreams. On top of all of this, Geoff was a loving husband and adored by his four kids. Then there was everything else he did on top of all of this that still has us all wondering how he fit it all in. Geoff will go down in history, an industry legend. He touched so many people's lives and has left imprints on our hearts. Geoff took pleasure in other people's achievements. He loved success and wanted it for everyone. So to whoever wins tonight, he'll be so proud that he's going to win the time.
See who you think is going to get this award, and then of course we have an audience choice award as well, which means someone can go home with two, someone can go home with none, which is fairly cruel and unusual. But Benjamin, who do you think gets the nod?
Again, both excellent. The marbles, helping others, responsibilities, it's relatable. But for me, Breathe offers a solution. It's simple, it focuses on well-being and prevention. So for me, black sheep.
Okay, all right. Feeling cocky? Yeah. Don't worry, champ, you're coming back. Okay. Natasha, how did you see it?
I'm ready to lose and then recover my marbles.
You going with marbles? All right, one all. Rowan Borg at Wimbledon, this is excellent. Jim, how did you find it?
Take a breath for me.
Take a breath? Alright. Jill.
Because we all need to survive and we need to breathe, so for me it's breathing.
Oh, 3-1, that's another saleable lead. And I still want to know, Julia, where did you go?
Marbles.
Marbles? Oh, so close. 3-2, and we just had quite a conversation. All right, now it's into the people's choice bit. So you get to cheer for. Oh, hang on. No. I'm just told you to stay. You totally have to go. thank you so much. Close to ruining everything, but not quite. Touch my damn spill, eh? Okay. We have a People's Choice Award. I would like to invite David Pearson, Executive Director of the Don Dunsman Fellowship Foundation, to present it, and then wrap up tonight's proceedings. So I will run around. David will stand here, and
quite dignified. I actually had a suit, this is true, the dry cleaner didn't get it done in time. I look quite good in a suit as well, don't just look at him. David will stand here and be dignified. I'll run around and try and make you cheer and stuff for anything. So think about which ad you would prefer to get this wonderful award. It's the 2007 AdMental Award in memory of Geoff Robertson, which is wonderful, and it's the People's Choice Award, which David will present. All right, so who's for breathing? You've got to get into this too. You've got to cheer and clap.
Shapes what we wear, what we buy, what we eat. It has incredible power to change minds, to have an influence, and what better cause to put the power of marketing to than to improve mental well-being. As we've heard tonight, 1 in 4 people have a mental illness. That's a lot of people in this room, but we know that everyone is affected by mental illness, by someone in their lives. And we know in Australia that mental illness is an issue that we don't really grapple with so well. And so tonight we've talked about well-being and resilience and how do we keep mentally healthy. But mental illness is a thing that really affects a lot of people in this country. Suicide, the toll in Australia is double the road toll, but most people wouldn't know that. The life expectancy of someone with a chronic mental illness in Australia is less than that of the life expectancy of our poorest regional neighbour, Papua New Guinea. If you have a chronic mental illness in Australia, you will live longer than our poorest neighbours. Mental illness is an incredibly important issue. Marketing is an incredibly powerful tool, and tonight we've brought those two things together, and it couldn't have been possible without all the help and support of the various people involved in tonight's event. So I really take great pleasure in thanking everyone involved. Can I start by thanking Greg Fleet for his wonderful work at NC? Thank you, Greg. To the agencies, I couldn't have hoped for better ads. They were fantastic. To the event partners, they started as an idea many months ago, and Kath Thomas from SA Health and I were chatting about it, and she just loved the idea and ran with it and said, this has to be part of Public Health Week. And without Kath and her team, Michelle Toster and everyone else at SA Health, today just simply would not happen. So thank you, Kath. Thank you to the AUC for the marketing industry for seizing this idea, for just getting behind it in such a big way, and particular thanks to the Nation for the wonderful work they did. To Geoff and Greg, I thought we should call this event Mental Health and Wellbeing and the Gruen Effect, and I don't reckon half of you would have been here if we called it that. I reckon AdMental and the wonderful artwork that you guys did just showed what this event wanted to be, that it's fun, that it's interesting, and it's bringing together these two worlds. So well done. To the generous contribution of Return to Work SA, mental illness or mental injury is occurring at twice the rate in the workplace than physical injury. And so that's why it's so important that the Return to Work SA, and so wonderful that they have supported today's event, along with the Flinders Foundation, and the great work that they're doing. So thank you very much for those two partners. To Flinders University for supporting us, for Adelaide University for hosting us, to the Mental Health Coalition, to the Mental Health Fellowship of South Australia, to the Faye Fuller Foundation, and the Samory Wellbeing and Resilience Centre. Thank you very much to all of those supporters as well. Uh, There is material about all of those organisations when you came in, so please have a look, take some information away. I encourage you to get involved in the organisations that are here tonight and have been represented. The purpose of the Don Dunstan Foundation is to inspire action for a fairer world, and we hope that tonight, by bringing marketing and mental health issues together, we have inspired you to think about what action you can take. And I encourage you to partner with the organisations that are here to take more information, to have conversations, to talk about the issue that is women's mental health. And yes, so please do that. to the panel, normally we would give you a gift at this point in time, like some wine or some chocolates, but this is Public Health Week. So what we thought we would do is we would do something different, and what we've done is we've given you all a cash gift, and we've given it through the Good Thanks micro donations platform. And so you'll get an email, and with the gift to all the speakers tonight, you'll get an email, and you can donate that gift to your favourite mental health charity. And last but not least, thank you very much everyone for coming and for being part of this wonderful event. There are drinks outside, so please hang around. The alcoholic drinks will be on the inside. There's some soft drinks outside. You can take your alcoholic drinks outside if you like, but there are only allowed to be served inside, and please don't wander too far outside the university or I'll get in lots of trouble. But other than that, thank you very much for coming, and thanks again to everyone involved.